Well, good morning and a really warm welcome to our service at Millbrook Church of the Nazarene. We're so glad that you could join with us and we're going to begin our service with some worship together. Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what a Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. O hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, O God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. O Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, O God. You have done great. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You will do great things. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. O hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive, break every chain, O God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. O Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, O God. You have done great. Above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. O hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, O God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. O Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, O God. You have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things. So you're very welcome to our service in Millbrook this morning, and we've managed to get back into the hall this week to socially distance and record this for this morning, and that feels exciting, and the band are excited to get back together, but we're more excited to be here to worship God together. Just one announcement I wanted to bring with you to you this morning is that we're planning to have a special service, a real
in Carrickfergus Church of the Nazarene on Sunday, the 25th of October. So because of the size of that church, that's allowed all of us that normally attend, or those that have been following Millbrook Church of the Nazarene, to attend on that day. It's 4 p.m. service, and everybody is extremely welcome. We'll be there socially distanced, following the guidelines, assuming the guidelines still permit us to go ahead with that service. So I just wanted to share that with you this morning. So Sunday, the 25th of October, 4 p.m., we're going to have a service in Carrickfergus Church of the Nazarene, and we'd love to see you there with us. Let's now just pray together. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for, Lord, all that you've done for us. Lord, we just thank you that we have this opportunity to worship you, Lord, and just it feels exciting, Lord, to worship, Lord, together as a group. This morning, we're also excited just to hear from you. Lord, we just thank you for your servant, Lord, and the word that she will share with us. Lord, help us this morning as we hear from you to be encouraged by it, Lord. Help us to be challenged by it, Lord, and to be changed by it. Lord, we know that you can do all things, and we just pray that we'll be open to hear from you this morning. We pray for those in our congregation, Lord, that need your touch this morning, Lord, whether that's in health, Lord, or Lord, in other ways, Lord, that you will just be all that you need, they need you to be to them this morning, Lord. We're just excited to hear from you today, and we ask all these things now in your name's sake. Let's continue to worship together.
Praise him, all you sinners. Sing, oh, sing, you weary. Oh, praise him, all you children of God. We lift high his glory, shown throughout our story. We praise him as the children of God. Our great Redeemer, glorious Savior, your name is higher than the rising sun. Light of the morning, you shine forever. Your name is higher than the rising sun. Your name is higher than the rising sun. His name forever. Speak it loud and clear now. Oh, praise him, all you children of God. Our great Redeemer, glorious Savior, you shine forever. Your name is higher than the rising sun. Your name is higher than the rising sun. Oh, 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 oh.
Oh,
God, you reign. Simply to speak your name is praise. Oh, our great Redeemer, glorious Savior, your name is higher than the rising sun. Light of the morning, you shine forever. Your name is higher than the rising sun. Your name is higher than the rising sun. exalt thee.
Good morning, and it is so lovely to have you with us in our socially distanced service today. It's lovely to be back in the hall. I just want to thank the praise band for leading us so beautifully in worship today. He is exalted. He is worthy of all honor and praise and glory. And now as we come to the word of God, let's just unite our hearts in prayer. Father, we thank you that you are good and you are mighty. Lord, we thank you that you love us. We thank you that we can glorify your name. Lord, we thank you that you are the name above every other name, and yet you are right here. You are here, Lord, as we meet together. You are in our homes as we watch on our screens. Lord, you are here in every moment of our lives. And Lord, as you are here, I pray that you would speak to us today. Lord, we give you permission to speak into our hearts and into our lives. Lord, I give you permission to speak to me. Call, challenge, equip, refresh, restore. Lord, whatever it is you need to do, Lord, do it among your people and those who are listening today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, we're continuing our study of Mark. We continue in the Gospel of Mark. We're reaching the end of the book, and at the end of the book, it really begins to slow down. It really begins to slow down as we approach the cross. And I think the writer, John Mark, really wants us to stop and think and ponder every word that is said. So we're going to read from Mark chapter 10. I haven't said this for a long time, but if you've got your Bibles or your phones or your iPads, you can flick or click to Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14, verse 43. We're starting at verse 43. Immediately, even as Jesus said this, Judas, one of the 12 disciples, arrived with a crowd of men armed with swords and clubs. They had been sent by the leading priests, the teachers of the religious law, and the elders. The traitor, Judas, had given them a prearranged signal. You will know which one to arrest when I greet him with a kiss. Then you can take him away under guard. As soon as they arrived, Judas walked up to Jesus. Rabbi, he exclaimed, and gave him the kiss. The others grabbed Jesus and arrested him. But one of the men with Jesus pulled out his sword and struck the high priest's sleeves, slashing off his ear. Jesus asked them, "Am I some dangerous revolutionary that you come with swords and clubs to arrest me? Why didn't you arrest me in the temple? I was among you teaching every day. But these things have happened to fulfill what the scripture says about me." Then all his disciples deserted him and ran away. One young man following behind was clothed only in a long linen shirt, and when the mob tried to grab him, he slipped out of the shirt and ran away naked. And we pray that God would bless the reading of his word. Just a little aside before we start into the sermon, because I know that I love a little bit of history, and I like to bore you with that too. But I don't know if you know that this is the passage of scripture where Mark himself makes a guest appearance. Historians will tell us that it was Mark's house that the Last Supper or that Passover meal was separated in. And the story goes like this, that as a teenager, Mark snuck out of the house in his nightshirt and his long linen gown, and he followed Jesus and the disciples. And then, of course, this mob arrives, and John Mark is terrified, and they grab and arrest Jesus, and the mob try to grab him too, and he wriggles out of his shirt and runs off naked. Now, obviously, I can't prove that story, but I do love a little bit of history, and it's a little aside before we come into our service or our sermon today. Today we really want to look at Judas and this betrayal with a kiss. Judas goes along to the high priests and the temple leaders, and he arranges this price of 30 pieces of silver. It doesn't seem enough to betray his Messiah and Savior. I don't know what has happened in Judas' mind. Maybe it was that final straw as the woman breaks in and opens that jar of perfume, and what a waste he thinks, and that's the final straw, and he eventually goes to the temple leaders. And he arranges this pre-sign, this signal of who Jesus is. It makes it worse that it's a kiss, doesn't it? That was the normal greeting. I know it's maybe not how we greet today. I'm very thankful for that, to be honest. But it was how they greeted in the Bible times. They greeted each other with a kiss. It wasn't out of the ordinary in those days. But it was a greeting of friendship. I often think it would have been easier if Judas had just went up and said, "Here he is, this is the one," or, "Lord, they made me do it." But that kiss, it just makes the betrayal even worse, doesn't it? And as I read that story in Mark chapter 14, it made me think of other kisses in the Bible. I know that you may not have researched that, but it's one of the things that I thought of. I thought about the prodigal son who comes home just absolutely dejected, and he knows that he's gone too far, and he comes home and he says to his dad, "I'm no longer worthy to be your son. Just let me be a servant in your house." And before he even gets the word out, the father just embraces him and he gives him a kiss. That's a kiss of restoration. Jesus got a kiss of betrayal. And then I thought about Acts chapter 20. You may not know this story, but it says persecution really comes in thick and fast on the church. Paul is really on the run. They're out to get him, and he knows that soon he's going to be arrested. And he's speaking to his friends from Ephesus. He's known them for years now. And he says to them, "This is the last time I'm going to see you." And they begin to get upset and they weep together and they pray together and they give him a kiss goodbye. So we see kisses of restoration, of betrayal, of goodbye. But the kiss that I really thought about today was one that we find in the story of Ruth, or the book of Ruth. It's really the story of Naomi. Naomi and her husband Elimelech, they go and they live in a land called Moab. They're really Jewish people and they probably shouldn't have done that. They should have stayed near Bethlehem, their hometown. But they do. They go off and they live in the land of Moab. And at first, everything is absolutely fantastic. They have two sons, one called Mahlon and one called Chilion. They grow up and they meet two Moabite women. Everything's great. They marry Ruth. One marries a girl called Orpah. And life is good. And all of a sudden, tragedy strikes the home of Naomi. First of all, her husband dies. And I'm sure at that time she found comfort and support in her two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, and in her daughters-in-law as well. But then further disaster comes to her house. And then her two sons die, first Mahlon and Chilion, and they die. And she is left with nothing. Now, I don't know if you know much about Jewish law, but in those days, at that time, in that culture, the inheritance was only brought through the son. So not only did Naomi lose her husband, not only did she lose her family, she lost everything. She lost her inheritance as well. And the culture goes that the daughter-in-law would stay with Naomi. So now she had no income, no husband, no sons, and two daughters-in-law in tow. What was she going to do? So she decides to do the only thing she could do. She goes back to Bethlehem. And on that journey, and in my head, they get to a certain point in a field where it's a kind of the point of no return. And Orpah and Ruth are with her, and she turns to them and says, "Go live your own lives, girls. I'm releasing you of any obligation that you have to me." But Ruth, she says, "No, I'm going to go with you. I'm going to go with you to Bethlehem." But Orpah, and here's what chapter 1 tells us. She kisses her mother-in-law and says goodbye. It wasn't a kiss of joy. It was a kiss of brokenness. A kiss that confirmed her sorrow, that sealed her grief. Naomi was truly broken and had nothing left. I don't know if you've ever been kissed by brokenness, whether tragedy has ever struck your home. I don't know if that's a kiss that you have received in your life. Or like Jesus, a kiss of betrayal, disappointment, and you've been let down severely, abandoned and left alone. These are the kisses that remind me of the story in Mark chapter 14. Naomi arrives in Bethlehem. All she's got is her daughter-in-law, Ruth, no inheritance, nothing at all. And her friends and her neighbors recognize her from years ago, and they come out to meet her, and they say, "Naomi, you've come home." Naomi says, "Don't even call me that anymore." So devastated by that kiss of brokenness, she wants to change her name. "Don't call me Naomi anymore," she says. "Call me Mara." That means bitterness. "Call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt so bitterly with me that I went out full and I have come back empty." And it was clear for all to see that Naomi had been kissed by brokenness and emptiness. And here we go back to the story of Jesus, and we back to that garden, and we see as Jesus stands alone, kissed by his betrayer. The disciples have run away, the crowd has dispersed, and Jesus stands before his accusers, betrayed by a kiss. They take him to the high priest's house, and the high priest begins to question him, and they try to find people that'll give evidence against him. Somebody comes up with a story about something he said about the temple being destroyed, and you remember we looked at that story, but there wasn't enough evidence, and the Bible says they could not get their story straight. Some people tried to witness against him, but they couldn't get enough people to do it. And it looked like everything might be okay when finally the high priest says, "Are you the Messiah?" And Jesus says, "I am." And the high priest, he has this big gesture of tearing his clothes and said, "Blasphemy! What more do you need? It's blasphemy!" The only problem was this, that the Jewish court had no authority in a Roman-occupied land. They were unable to issue the death sentence. So they had to kind of orchestrate that blasphemy would become a charge of treason. And so they sent him to Pilate's house, betrayed by a kiss. Let's go back to the story of Naomi. Naomi is in Bethlehem. It was the place where she grew up. She's called Mara. She's full of bitterness. She has been kissed by brokenness and grief. And as the days go on, something starts to happen. She wasn't able to be employed because that's how it was for women in those days. But Ruth, her daughter-in-law, the only thing that she had with her, she began to go into a field and she gleaned barley from the corners. That was the law of the corners of the field to do with Jewish law as well. It's so that the poor and the outcast would also have something to eat. And Ruth begins to glean the corners of the field when she meets a landowner, and this is where the love story starts. She meets a landowner, his name is Boaz, he owns the field where she's gleaning, and Ruth is able to take food home to feed her and Naomi. And you've already guessed it, but Ruth and Boaz fall in love. Now here's the amazing thing. Ruth and Boaz fall in love and they get married. But because of the Jewish law called the Levirate law, something amazing happens. Naomi not only gains a son and a family, but because of Boaz, her full inheritance is restored. Isn't that amazing that she is kissed by brokenness, but God doesn't leave her there? He does this work of restoration in her life and he brings her to a place where he restores not only family, but her inheritance. And it doesn't just finish there with the inheritance. It also happens whenever Ruth and Boaz have a son called Obed. Whenever her son is born, this son now belongs to Naomi too. Would he hear this bit? Those people that rushed out and she said, "Don't call me Naomi anymore, call me Mara, for I have nothing left. I've been kissed by brokenness." I imagine it's the same women come out when little Obed is born and Naomi's walking him down the street. I'm not sure if they had a pram. Maybe he was in a sling, but she is so proud and so delighted that he's there. And the women run up to her and do you know what they say? They don't say, "What a lovely grandson you've got there." They say, "Naomi has a son." Wow, what a work of restoration God does in our life, from that kiss of brokenness to that place of restoration. Now here's what I say when it comes to loss and tragedy, particularly when it comes to children. Having another child does not make up for the one that you lost, and I know and understand that. But oh boy, when the lows have been so low, the heights seem so much higher, and you sure appreciate even more what you have. In the story of restoration, brokenness to restoration, what did Naomi do to bring this story of restoration? Well, very little. God did it all. But the one thing she did was this. She came to Bethlehem. And if you've been kissed by brokenness or grief or emptiness, can I encourage you this morning to return to Bethlehem? Could it take you to that scene of the manger? Could it take you to that place where we remember that Jesus laid aside everything for us, aside his glory and majesty, and he came and he humbled himself to be born as a baby? And can I take you to Bethlehem this morning? Can I take you to the place where God promised to send a Savior, and then we are reminded that God keeps his promises? And if God keeps his promises in Bethlehem, let me assure you that he keeps them today. And do you know what he says in the Psalms? If he keeps his promises for a Savior of the world, wouldn't all his promises be true? Can't we trust him for all of those things? So when he says in the book of Psalms, "I am close to the brokenhearted," he is. "I am close to those who are crushed in spirit." And later on in the Psalms, he says, "Not only am I close to the brokenhearted, but I bind up their wounds." God is in the restoration business. Let me bring you to Bethlehem so that you can see that not only does God restore, but he keeps his promises. And that's not all. You see, Naomi and her daughter-in-law, then Boaz comes along and they have a son called Obed. Obed has a son called Jesse. And I'm sure you already know this story, but Jesse has several sons, the youngest of which is called David. David has a son called Solomon. Then we have Rehoboam. Then we have Abijah. Then Asa. Then Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat has a son called Jehoram. Jehoram has a son called Josiah. Josiah has a son called Jotham. Then Ahaz. Then Hezekiah. Manasseh. Has a son called Ammon. Ammon has a son called Josiah. Then Jehoiakim, Shealtiel, Zerubbabel, Abiud, Eliakim. These are all good names if you're having a son. Azor, Elihud, Elizor, and Mathan. And would you hear this bit? Mathan has a son called Jacob. Jacob has a son called Joseph who has married Mary. And Mary gives birth to Jesus who is called the Messiah. God not only restores Naomi's story, but in her brokenness, he restores the story of the world. He brings salvation to us even in that story of brokenness. Salvation still comes. Restoration is still here. And here we find that promised Messiah who came from that story of brokenness, and now he stands before his accusers, betrayed by a kiss. But here's the thing. If that was not the end of the story for Naomi, it certainly wasn't the end of the story for Jesus either. You see, whenever Jesus came and he was betrayed by that kiss, yes, he did go to the cross. But you know what? The story didn't finish there. Jesus was killed on the cross, but he was raised from the dead, and now he's ascended at the right hand of the Father God, where guess what? He's going to return because God keeps his promises. It's not the end of the story. And I want to remind you of that this morning. If you've been kissed by brokenness or emptiness or grief, maybe it's like Jesus' disappointment and betrayal, abandonment. Maybe you feel alone and rejected. It's not the end of the story. God is still in the restoration business. He is still restoring his people. He is still close to those who are brokenhearted. He is still comforting those who are crushed in spirit. And he is still binding up wounds. Won't you come to Bethlehem this morning and see God, the restorer of everything, keeping his promises? It's not the end of Naomi's story. It wasn't the end of Jesus' story, and it's not the end of yours. He is the healer of the brokenhearted, the binder of wounds, a God who keeps his promises. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are good and loving, that you restore, joy, that you restore hope, that you heal broken hearts, that you bind up our wounds. Lord, today we come to you, and some of us have been kissed by grief and tragedy, by brokenness and emptiness. And Lord, we ask that you would bind our wounds, that you would keep your promise, that you would be close to the brokenhearted. We pray, Lord, that you would just be with us, and Lord, that we would return to you, that we would come to that scene in Bethlehem where we are reminded that the Lord God Almighty give up everything for us to make everything right between us and you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
There is strength within the sorrow. There is beauty in our tears. You meet us in our mourning with a love that casts out fear. You are working in our waiting, sanctifying us. When beyond our understanding, teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. Us in the fire and the flood, you're faithful forever and perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. You are wisdom unimagined. Who could understand? Reigning high above the heavens, reaching down in endless grace. You're the lifter of the lowly, compassionate and kind. You surround and you uphold me. Your promises are my delight. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever and perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Even what the enemy means for evil, you turn it for our good. You turn it for our good, for your glory. Even in the valley you are faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good, for your glory. Even what the enemy means for evil, you turn it for our good. You turn it for our good, for your glory. Even in the valley you are faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good, for your glory. Even what the enemy means for evil, you turn it for our good. You turn it for our good, for your glory. Even in the valley you are faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good, for your glory. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us.
All Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for our time together this morning. Lord, we just thank that you are sovereign. Lord, we just thank you that you, Lord, that you are the in the power, you have the power for restoration. Lord, we just thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for our time together today. We ask all these things now. In your name's sake, we pray. Amen.